Good afternoon. As we go to air, a massive storm is hitting parts of Sydney. This is the radar from the Bureau of Meteorology. That's a massive wall of water heading east towards the coast. The red and orange areas predicting very heavy rain and hail. This was the scene just outside of Lithgow a short time ago, and that thick black cloud is moving fast. There are similar scenes all over Sydney's west. This one is at Glenmore Park. Heavy hail has started falling around the Hawkesbury, and it's expected to intensify as it heads towards the city and the coast. We will keep our eye on this and update you shortly. Now to breaking news from our mid-north coast. A day-long manhunt is over. Two men just taken into custody after a violent crime spree. Police now dealing with multiple crime scenes stretching almost 100 kilometres from Kupanook to Kempsey. Kate Creedon has the latest.
Well, just a short time ago, two men were arrested at Big W in Kempsey, heavily armed police taking them into custody. The men are believed to be responsible for shooting at several cars, including police, early this morning. Their terrifying crime spree beginning at Kupanook on the Pacific Highway, where a motorist was fired at, a bullet grazing the driver's arm at around 1:40 a.m. The youth then headed north, shooting at another motorist at the Hatch, then again shortly after at Kundabung, before turning around and heading into Port Macquarie along Fernbank Creek Road, where they shot at a police car. It was there on Fernbank Creek Road where a man's body was also found, but police won't confirm how or if they are linked at this stage. The abandoned ute was found shortly after, dumped at Wayne Richards Park, but there was no sign of the men at this stage. Police are yet to confirm if they're searching for anyone else.
Residents in the Port Macquarie area will notice that there's been a considerable increase in police resources. I want to reassure the public that the message to the residents is that they stay vigilant and report anything suspicious to police via 000.
The men are expected to be taken to Kempsey Police Station, where they're likely to be charged later this evening.
Outrage is growing over Optus's national network outage, which affected millions of customers. Hundreds of complaints have been sent to the telecommunications ombudsman. This afternoon, Optus has doubled down in ruling out any recourse for customers suffering damages from the tech blackout. Communications Minister Michelle Rowland says that's just not on.
It would seem very reasonable for Optus to look at how they can attempt to recompense people for this.
The federal government has also announced there will be a review into the telco's handling of the outage. A blaze has torn through a townhouse in Sydney's west, forcing those inside to run for their lives. Dozens of firefighters were needed to bring the fire under control. Hayley Francis has the story.
Well, it was thanks to working smoke alarms that the lives of two people were saved today when this Auburn townhouse erupted into flames just before 6 a.m. More than 20 firefighters responded to the fire, which is believed to have started on the ground floor. It's understood an elderly woman who lives in the home had woken up and switched on the TV before then falling asleep. Soon after, she was woken by the smoke alarm and could see the TV had then become a ball of fire.
My mum just woke up, so she was turned the TV on, went into the kitchen. Apparently, while the TV was on, TV started blowing up.
She ran upstairs to get her son, aged in his 30s, both thankfully making it out safely. Within minutes, the fire had spread, causing both the first floor and the roof to collapse.
As soon as I go outside, all I see, the neighbours across, house has fallen, like, literally collapsed. Smoke gone everywhere, everyone outside worried, shivering. It's very upsetting, very catastrophic as well.
It took just under 2 hours for firefighters to extinguish the blaze. Residents in four adjoining townhouses were also evacuated as a precaution. Fire investigators are now on scene and will spend several hours analysing the suspected cause of this blaze.
The Albanese government has suffered a defeat on its controversial industrial relations legislation. Federal politics reporter Eliza Edwards joins us now. Eliza, what's happened today?
Well, Lizzie, independent crossbenchers Jackie Labby and David Pocock had a win in the Senate this afternoon. They teamed up with the opposition to split the government's bill on workers' rights to pass the least contentious parts first. This includes simplifying compensation for first responders dealing with PTSD, as well as strengthening protections for employees who are victims of domestic violence. So these are the parts of the legislation that had unanimous support, but there are other elements of the closing loopholes bill that are facing staunch opposition. Labor wanted the entire bill to go through together, but it became clear today it didn't have the numbers in the Senate, so the government backed the move by the crossbench. However, the government does have the numbers in the lower house, so they won't let these parts of the bill pass there next week. It prompted this reaction from Independent Jackie Lambie.
That would not be a smart way to play politics. It was a stupid way they did it in the first place. Surely they couldn't get dumber, dumb and dumber, surely.
Lizzie, business groups have described some of the government's IR changes as radical, while unions say they'll ensure workers are properly paid. There's been a long fight over these laws and it's certainly not over yet.
Eliza Edwards there for us in Canberra. A landmark ruling in the High Court has opened the possibility for more than 90 people detained indefinitely to be freed. The decision overturns a 20-year precedent which sees unsuccessful asylum seekers who can't return to their original country held in detention. The federal government says it is currently considering the judgment. Around 15,000 Palestinians, including women and children, have fled northern Gaza in the past 24 hours as close quarters fighting between Israeli troops and Hamas intensifies. Some holding their arms in the air or waving white flags to ensure their safety as they escape. The Israeli army claims to have destroyed 130 tunnels and seized weapons belonging to Hamas from inside people's homes. It comes as US Secretary of State Antony Blinken warned that Israel cannot reoccupy Gaza after the conflict with Hamas ends.
There may be a need for some transition period at the end of the conflict, but it is imperative that the Palestinian people be central to governance in Gaza.
Mr. Blinken, who's attending the G7 foreign ministers meeting in Tokyo, also urged for diplomatic efforts towards peace to start immediately. Australia's top three cherry growers have battled it out for the title of best box of the season, all for a great cause. CEO of the Sydney Children's Hospitals Foundation and former Premier Christina Keneally had the enviable and delicious task of taste testing the nation's best cherries. Wandon Valley Farms declared the winner.
To me, it was all about flavour. It was about that burst of juicy cherry flavour in the mouth, a really meaty cherry. Last year, we raised $80,000 by auctioning off that first box of cherries. This year we're hoping to meet and hopefully exceed that.
The kids that are sick, we need to try and support them and make a happy day for them.
The winning box will go under the hammer in this weekend's cherry auction, with all money raised to ensure children living with cancer in regional New South Wales can receive care closer to home. NAB remains optimistic Australia can avoid a recession despite struggling borrowers being hit with another interest rate rise. The declaration came as the bank unveiled a $7.7 billion profit. Finance editor Chris Kohler explains.
NAB today announced a $7.7 billion cash profit for the year, up nearly 9%. So while interest rate hikes are hurting customers, banks seem to be doing okay. We also saw a $7.2 billion profit from Westpac on Monday and a $10 billion result from CBA back in August.
It's still a huge amount of money, it's still an incredible profit, but it is in perspective that the amount of lending that this country does is now in trillions, not in billions.
But CEO Ross McEwen says his bank's margins are actually shrinking.
We had a very good first half. And, you know, banks do benefit out of interest rates going up for a period of time, but that got pretty well competed out in the second half.
NAB says the number of people calling the bank for help because they're struggling has surged by more than 60% this year, spiking every time they pass on an RBA rate increase.
Of our total mortgage book, there's about 10,000 customers that we've made adjustments for them to make sure that they can stay in their home and continue to make payments on their mortgage.
He's sitting on this tightrope of, I've got a customer problem, I've got a profit problem, I've got a shareholder problem that I'm trying to balance.
The next bank to announce a profit will be ANZ on Monday. It's also expected to be well into the billions of dollars.